My great-great-grandfather came over here to this country in 1828 from Germany, and apparently he had the desire to get in the beer business and landed in Pottsville, Pennsylvania, because I think of the mountainous terrain and the natural resource of good water that we have here. Well, this was an area that coal had just been discovered about a decade earlier, maybe two decades earlier. And Pottsville was a growing, thriving little community with the Welsh and the German immigrants who mined the coal. So each community in this area had its own brewery. Pottsville, being a lot of German ancestry, they drank D.G.'s beer, his lager beer back in those days. The brewery's been in our family since 1829. It's always been run by a member of the family, and somebody always wanted to take it over. And that's what I'm so grateful for, because there have been so many ups and down years, such as Prohibition. We went through terrible years in the 50s, which is when I started here. The 50s and 60s were very dismal years for the small brewery because of the growth of the national brands. So many of our competitors around here went out of business, and we're the only ones that survived. In 1985, when I bought the company from my father, I saw these craft beers, brew pubs, microbreweries coming up with these different brews and introducing the public to different tasting beers. The beers in this country have gotten kind of blah, very little character to it. It's sold for the masses. It's sold on television, not by word of mouth that this is a good beer. It's sold on television. But we've been making these products since the brewery was started in 1829. We've made porters and ales and a lager for 160 years, 170 years. So why shouldn't we be able to get into this thing and see how well we can do in this segment of the industry? Well, it turns out that we did very well. I mean, I never expected our company to grow as it is.
Brewmaster must have a good knowledge of the complete operation, especially in a smaller plant. So you're responsible for the products, the ones that you aren't using, and maybe development of new products. The whole plant operation, from steam generating to right straight through. Of course, it's the brewing is most important, the actual brewing cycle. But then you get involved in refrigeration, steam generation, bottling shop operation, because everything ties in. What goes on in a bottling shop could affect your product, your pasteurization and many other things. So you must have a pretty good knowledge of how all this ties in. And we have good personnel here. We have an excellent crew. We try to explain to them why certain things have to be done a certain way so that they understand why they're doing things, not just push a button or turn a valve or whatever. And if a fellow understands what he's trying to do, why he's trying to do it, which is the right way, the wrong way, that's 90% of the battle.
Well, I've been here 26 years. I've been through just about every job in the place, starting in the bottling shop before palletization, before we had our warehouse in, just stacking cases off by hand. And from there I went to the cellars, tank cleaning, scrubbing around everything, rack and cellar, wash house, filling the kegs, Then eventually I became the first man in the fermenting cellars. And from there I became assistant brewmaster, and here I am today.
How heavy is one of those pigs?
160 pounds.
How many of you lift in a day?
There's 12 to a pallet, and I'm not sure how many pallets you're doing one day.
How many of you think you lift in a day?
Probably about 200 or 300.
200 or 300?
At least. Not really, your legs kind of, maybe your shoulders. If your back hurts, you're lifting them.
Racking room is where we have all our draft beer. Of course, the kegs are filled. We have four guns. Fill the kegs. The kegs are filled through the side, through the bung hole, not the cork hole, the bung hole. And they're kicked off as they're filled. And the guys out front palletize them. There are weightlifters of the brewery. We win championships all the time. And they're palletized and on their way out the door. Usually they don't even sit in there. They're right on the trailer and down the road. Well, the cork you see in the keg actually is not a cork, it's a bung, it's a wooden dowel. And the different colors on them represent the different varieties of product. As in turn, orange would be lager, green would be Chesterfield ale, blue would be light beer, white would be premium, red would be black and tan. We have a wood burner down in the racking cellar, and it actually burns the number of the day of the year into the bung, which we could, that's how we can track it. If somebody brings something back and says, hey, this is sour or no good, we can just look at the bung and we know when it was produced.
This cake's in the fridge.
Oh yeah, yeah. With they're under pressure all the time. So if your local beer man's coming to your house to drop a half off of you and he accidentally drops it and hits the curb, why, it'll probably crack and start leaking. We have a big turnover of leakers. But it can happen because the kegs are under pressure and they're getting older. The steel is thin on, you know, from being warped. But yes, they can leak.
We've been here so long, when we started, they didn't even have packaged beer. All the beer sold was in wooden kegs on draft. And as in the 1870s or 1880s, pasteurization was discovered by Louis Pasteur. So that gave brewers the opportunity to package beer, and we packaged it in small white bottles, brown bottles. It almost seems like they put beer in anything they could get, though they could put a top on it. As time went on, they discovered that you could put beer in cans, and I can remember here filling cans that were the old cone top can. It was shaped like a small bottle of beer with a, came to a cone, and you filled it with the bottle filler and put a crown on it. Then they got into the flat top cans, and I've seen the pull top can arrived in about the 1960s, I believe. And now they were steel in those days. They were steel cans. Today they're aluminum cans that almost puncture a hole in them if you look at them wrong. Bottles, it was all returnable bottles. The brewers had their own bottles, and our bottles had our name etched in them, and so did everybody else's. We've gotten bottles back here with Joseph Schlitz Brewing Company on it, and the Stegmeyer Brewing Company, a lot of the local breweries. Today, they're getting away from the returnable package, and it seems like everybody's going into the long neck throwaway bottles or short neck throwaway bottles. Everything's a disposable market in this day and age. So we've seen a lot of change, and whether it's for the better, I don't know. We still make a returnable bottle, and for a small brewer, it's highly unusual, but we sell a lot of returnables.
Today today we're running our returnable bottles, and that's probably our slowest package that we run. And everyone here gets a little bored with it because they get used to running in the higher speeds. Returnables go about 250 a minute. And when we run our NRs, which are our throwaway bottles, that's up around 426 bottles a minute. And cans is our fastest package. That goes about 510 cans per minute. We'll run, because our bottles and our cans share the same pasteurizer, we can't do both on the same day. So generally what we do is bottle usually about 4 days a week, and then we'll take one day where we'll run strictly cans. And it also helps us because then we can do our preventive maintenance and any kind of work and greasing that needs to be done on the bottling line on that day that we're running cans.
The only thing we pasteurize is the bottles, the cans. Draft beer is not pasteurized because you figure draft beer would have a quicker turnover, and it doesn't give it that pasteurized taste. But a lot of people like draft beer better because of that reason. But pasteurization initially kills any bacteria or any growth of any type that would be in the product and provides a longer shelf life for it.
Okay, what we're doing now is we're going to put our trilinear recorder into the pasteurizer, and that's how we check the temperature of the bottles and make sure that the zone for the pasteurization zone is getting the proper amount of time, which is anywhere from 12 to 15 minutes. And this is our traveling recorder.
Part of our limiting factors here at the brewery are the fact that some of our machines are so very old. We have our bottle washer and our pasteurizer, which are both from the 1950s. And it's easy to say, oh, well, why don't you just get a new one? Well, that's an easy solution, and we'd love to do that. But we are so landlocked here, being built on the hill the way we are, and we have the church right next door, that to bring a whole new machine like that into this bottle shop would require probably taking a wall out to then get the old machine out, bring the new one in. And then besides that, if we're getting into such a busy season right now with our summer season and everyone's crying for more beer and production, all the downtime with that, it would just be a major project. And we're hoping we can just mend through things and work our way through the next couple of years until the new plant is built. And then we can take some time and do the fixing that needs to be done here and take the required measures for that.
I am now placing it into the pasteurizer, which will take anywhere from 25 to 30 minutes to come out on the back end of the pasteurizer. And then that'll tell me the amount of temperature and the amount of time that the bottles are getting in the pasteurization zone.
This brewery was not designed, this brewery grew. And any brewery that grows, it's like it grows into the available space, much like a tree or a plant or something. Well, there's not necessarily a lot of logic to it. You build a building where you've got room to build a building, and then you run pipes or do whatever's necessary. So a lot of the infrastructure, things like boilers, the boilers were in terrible condition, and we've got a cooling system which probably dates back to 1910. Pipes that run under the street that are too small and you can't fix them.
But after 1960, we made a lot of changes. There are a lot of areas where we were far behind. Some of the major changes I'll mention were in the engineering end. We had steam-driven ammonia compressors. We had steam-driven DC generators, 110 voltage, which were very inefficient and ready to die. We were handling grits in bags, so we changed that to bulk handling. Saved a lot of labor, a lot of muss and fuss.
So where does that, how are the grits transported?
They are handled by our air veyor system. Call it a vacuum system.
And how do they get to Pottsville?
The railroad cars come into the Pottsville area about 2 miles from here. We have an overhead trestle, and we back a dump trailer under there, drop in the grits and malt. We also get our malt that way. Drop them into the trailer. Trailer comes up here. We hook on an aerator system, a 4-inch vacuum hose or suction, whatever you want to call that, and we pull it from the trailer. We elevate the trailer bed, and the grain flows to the back, and we suck it up with this vacuum system up into our storage bins.
These are our malt bins. They hold approximately 200 to 40,000 pounds each.
How tall are they?
Approximately 40 foot for about four stories of this building. A lot of people drive by here don't realize there's grain silos right here in Pottsville because they're all bricked in, you can't see them.
In terms of from a brewer's point of view, the hardest beers to make, I think it's fair to say, are the ones that have the least taste and the least color. Okay, so our light beer is probably our hardest to make. And then as you go up in color and aroma, the brews become more and more forgiving. I'm saying we put the same amount of care into making all of them. Again, I mean, we use the same process. But in a porter, there's a lot more than there is in a light. So any variation in the process, if the yeast are left too long on the beers, or you have a yeast crop that's in poor condition, you have a slow fermentation, somebody adds a little bit too much of a caramel malt into a light product, that taste variation is going to show up.
This is the first vessel in the brewing process, known as the cereal cooker. Here we take cereal grains and cook them, hence the name cereal cooker. Cereal grain that we use here at Yuengling is corn grits. We take corn grits, mash them into water. We heat the water up along with the grains, doing saccharification of the grain, which is turning all the starches naturally to sugar. We take it up.
Each brew, you require a certain amount of grits, a certain amount of malt, and of course a certain amount of water. Well, the water in this general area is soft and is very good brewing water. The soft water is important. If you have hard water, then you got to soften the water because you want a certain amount of minerals in your water, but if you get over a certain limit, you're in trouble again, so you have to remove them, and we're fortunate that our water is soft.
My corn grits are done boiling, and I'm ready to add them to the mash tub and the malt barley, and they will convert from starch to sugar.
What you've got here is wort coming out of the water tub. Now, wort is beer that has not been fermented yet. The yeast hasn't put on it yet. So it's classified wort at this stage, but this vessel up above us, which is running through here, is the lager tub. The lager tub separates the liquid in the grains from the grains themselves so that we can take it out of the lager tub and move it into the kettle. It gets moved into the kettle. It's approximately 170 degrees now, but it gets moved into the kettle where we're going to boil it to clarify it even more and to add the hops to it.
When the wort comes from the brew house, we put the yeast in it in the fermenting cellar. The process takes approximately 7 to 8 days to ferment out. During this time, the tanks are checked periodically every day for temperature rise and fall, and also for specific gravity. And the specific gravity is how we check the alcohol in the product. So we have a hydrometer and it's like a copper cylinder we fill with beer. and you drop your hydrometer in, and depending on your reading, as your gravity falls throughout fermentation, that's how we can tell how much alcohol is in the product. We have chalkboards on all the tanks to keep a daily record of the tank's temperature and as the specific gravity falls throughout fermentation.
How long have you had those chalkboards?
Since 1829.
Procedures here at the brewery or we do taste panel or taste testing twice a week. Each Tuesday and Thursday morning we have a taste panel lined up, and the other brewmasters and myself are all a part of this. And what we do is we test products that we're currently packaging that day, whether it's here in the bottle shop or down in the racking room. We'll test brands that are already in storage. They may be in the finishing cellars. Brands that are along the way, so that if there is a problem, they can detect it there and catch it before it gets packaged. And we also test for packages that maybe have been manufactured a month or so ago, just to see how far that they've broken down.
Almost every brewmaster would say that that's the best lab. You know, I mean, here's your spectrophotometer and here's your gas chromatograph. Human tastes, the tastes of a trained taster are much better than anything which has been devised to actually to evaluate flavor. And that was always been the tool for troubleshooting by the brewer. That diastole, for instance, is a buttery taste which can get in beer. And dimethyl sulfide, that tastes like, smells like cooked corn. Okay, and they're parts of the process which give rise to these tastes. And so if you don't want them in a beer, you do things to make sure that they're taken care of in the process. Well, if you taste them, then you can go back to that part of the process and fix it, you know, avoid it. And so all brewers are trained to be tasters. And professional brewers taste much differently than, say, a beer connoisseur. I mean, they're doing tasting and looking for defects in the product, and they're looking for they approach the tasting part as part of process analysis. So that's the way you keep control of your process, tasting it. Now, drinking is different. Okay, I mean, when I went to Siebel's and learned to brew, I'd never had a beer I didn't like, and then I learned to taste, and it took me about 3 months to a year to find one I did again, because I kept, you know, just have a beer, you just turn that off.
It's memory of a miner who dragged himself to work, worked himself to death, working for someone else. We follow each other around on shaky ground. His life had become to him worthless in many ways, an expired product off the shelf, working for someone else.
Well, 170 years ago or so, when the brewery was built, we first year in business, DG sold about 600 barrels of beer, and you know, it was all shipped with horses and wagons, and done all locally. Probably rolled the cakes to the local saloons. Well, today we're in the same location doing over 500,000 barrels. Modern equipment, there's 53-foot trailers, 48-foot trailers with these huge tractors, and here we are in the same location trying to do the same thing that the individual that founded the brewery 170 years ago did. And it's very, very difficult. It's a nightmarish situation at times around here. And if you did this film in the winter time, when we had an inch of snow on the ground, it'd be more like a comedy than a historical film. But we do amazingly well, and there's people that come in here and they know breweries, and they know what our limitations are, and they kind of marvel at what we get out of this plant, knowing the location and what we have to work with here.
Now it's down to the wire, facing 6 feet under.
Well, it amounts to is, well, basically, if you think you know everything about everything, you're in trouble. You don't have all the answers to everything. You must keep up with technology and try to keep efficient. If not, you're in trouble. Plant's in trouble, you're in trouble. So you have to try to keep up with things and keep your finger on top of everything.
Well, as our brands began to not only grow but explode in the Pennsylvania market and Delaware and New Jersey, we had to do something to accommodate these wholesalers. So we had to pull out of all the New England states. We were selling beer in Boston. We were doing nice business in the Boston market, Maine, down through New York City. So now we've shrunk our market down to basically three states. And we sell an awful lot of beer in just those three states. Someday, we hope to get back into those markets. People like our products, and the key is, I think, people like us. We're not a corporate conglomerate. We're a small family-owned brewery, makes good beers. We package them well. I think we have a good reputation, and that's why I feel we can continue to be successful. I have four daughters, and two of whom are working here. They started about 2 years ago, and they're learning all the different aspects of the brewing business. In 20 years, I think I'll look at these four kids and see what a great job four girls are doing with a little brewery in Pottsville.